Welcome again. I must say that this is indeed a privilege and an honor to moderate a panel at Hunter, one of my favorite colleges at the City University of New York, and to moderate with the top founders of what I believe is my field on immigration, Professor Alba and Professor Foner. So this is indeed a great treat. Let me introduce to you the panelists, and I understand each one of you will have 15 minutes and that I'll be reminded if of timing and policing. Let me introduce Professor Richard Alba, Distinguished Professor of Sociology at the Graduate Center at the City University of New York, and he'll be speaking along with Professor Nancy Foner, also a Distinguished Professor of Sociology at Hunter College. And the Graduate University of New York. They'll be speaking about their latest research on the integration challenges, or paper, I should rather say, integration challenges and opportunities in the wealthy West, based on their findings, comparative findings of the integration to school and the labor market of the children of immigrants in Europe and the United States. And then the panel will be followed by Professor Shawn Bushway, Professor of Public Administration and Policy at the Rockefeller College of Public Affairs at the University of Albany, State of New York. And he will be speaking about his research on the effects of incarceration on labor market outcomes among young adults and the relevance for labor market integration and negative effects. Finally, we'll have a third presenter, Dr. Andy Stern, former president of the Service Employees International Union, who has collaborated a lot in this country in terms of social movements and labor market reforms. So we have a very interesting panel, and I welcome you all. Richard, you can begin. Yes.
Thank you, Norma. Well, let's see if this, here we go. So I'm going to speak. Since we only have 15 minutes, it really doesn't make sense to do a tag team presentation with Nancy running up to kind of take it over halfway. As you can see from our title, our focus is really on sort of demographic diversity and what it means for unemployment and underemployment. And this is also a paper that is not just focused on the United States, but looks at a number of societies in Western Europe as well. It comes out of our book, which was published this spring by Princeton University Press, called Strangers No More. And as I kind of raised with at the end of the last session, there's a demographic part to this story that I think has so far been underplayed in the conference, and I want to now call attention to it. And one aspect of that demographic story is kind of really an enormous transition that's underway in all of the wealthy Western societies as they become demographically more diverse, largely as a consequence of immigration. And there's going to be a handoff, in a way, in the labor market over the next 25 years as the very large baby boom cohorts, which occurred everywhere, not just in the United States, at the end of World War II, as they exit from the ages of economic and, let's say, civic activity, and the new cohorts that are rising to replace them are much more diverse than those that are aging out. And in particular, they have a great deal of diversity that is a consequence of immigration. So here's how this picture looks in the United States. And I want to underscore again, I would now wish I had one of the Northern European population pyramids to also show. They're very different from the American one. So in the United States, you can see the baby boom in 2010. That's the people, that's the bulges at the in the ages 45 to 64. Notice how wide the red portion of the bars is. That represents the majority population, so-called majority population, defined here as non-Hispanic whites. And so as they age out, there will be many fewer non-Hispanic whites coming into the labor market. In other words, those workers who have very good jobs on the whole are not going to be replaced by people belonging to the same population. So the challenge is here to really integrate people of minority origins so that they can replace the departing workers. And as you can see, in 2035, it's a very different relationship between the red and the blue portions of the bars. The blue represents minorities, so the minorities represent a larger proportion of the adult population and a very large proportion of the young adult population. If we had Germany, the population pyramid for the present would actually look more like a Weihnachtsbaum, you don't mind my using a German word here. So we would have like a tree-like structure, and then under the age of 35, it would be a very narrow pipeline of young people, more like a tree trunk, a narrow tree trunk. And so it's a very different challenge in the Northern European countries than it is here in the United States. So we focus in the book on what we call low-status immigrant groups, which are the more challenging ones to integrate. And so these can be defined as immigrants and their children, where the immigrants are low-wage labor-seeking immigrants, like Mexicans in the United States or North Africans in France, and also groups that are stigmatized to some extent because of their ethnic, racial, religious origins. And these, from the point of view of the youth population, these are very consequential groups. For example, in the United States and in the Netherlands, 1 in 4 children now come from immigrant homes. It's a little lower in Britain and France, but it's still consequential at 1 in 6. And high percentages of these immigrant origin youth come from what we are calling low status origins. In the Netherlands, 2/3 of the immigrant origin children come from non-Western families. The largest groups among them are the Moroccans and the Turks. 60% of the immigrant origin children in the United States have Caribbean or Latin American backgrounds. Half in France have backgrounds, family origins in either North Africa or in Sub-Saharan Africa. So this is a big deal. So how do these young people look in educational terms? And here I'm going to focus on the lower end of the educational spectrum, because these are the young people who are particularly vulnerable than in the labor market. And this isn't all of the data in our book, but it's just enough to give you the flavor of our findings. And what you can see actually at the lower end is a quite consistent story, though the absolute percentages vary. It's clear that there are everywhere important disadvantages for immigrant origin youth compared to those coming from the mainstream backgrounds. In some cases, those disadvantages look very large. In Germany, for example, where the rate of leaving school without a final secondary credential is 3 times higher for the Turkish origin youth than it is for the native German youth. You may be wondering about the figures in England and Wales, where the numbers are like half compared to 40% for the white British. So in the British case is a somewhat special case, because you can leave school at age 16 after passing the GCSE examinations, which is not a diploma, but it is a kind of qualification in the labor market. Given what I'm going to say on the next slide, given the discrimination against second-generation youth in the labor market in Great Britain and in other countries, this is probably a more favorable situation for white British youth who have the social capital, more likely to have the social capital to get a job, than it is for these minority youth. And you can see these are very large numbers. Arnie raised the question of the German case in apprenticeship, so let me say a little bit about that. So, you know, the majority of the Turkish origin youth at least have a basic secondary credential. Many of these young people, both native Germans and immigrant minorities, are seeking apprenticeships along with that basic secondary credential. There's very good evidence that the native German youth are favored in these apprenticeship programs. So the story of disadvantage in the educational pipeline continues when we look at the apprenticeship program. So the Turkish young people have had greater difficulty in getting apprenticeships and then in getting good apprenticeships, ones that lead to careers as opposed to irregular employment. So what do we know about the second generation in the labor market? Well, I would say that the evidence that we have is inadequate. A lot of the studies really reflect the situation during the first decade of the 21st century. And of course, we're also dealing with cohorts of young people that are still relatively young. So we really don't know kind of how their labor market careers or trajectories will work out over the longer haul. But I think it's a fair statement to make that pretty much everywhere, the second generation of low status origins, net of their educational attainment, comparing them to native origin youth who are equal in educational attainment, they have A, higher unemployment rates, and they have B, in one or another respect, lower quality jobs when they are employed. So in Britain, the remarkable finding in education has been that the what are regarded as the lowest status groups, Bangladeshi and Pakistanis, have caught up in university credentials. And that's an interesting story, not really well understood. Nevertheless, it's clear that net of their education, they have higher unemployment rates, and they are more likely to be employed by minority employers than majority employers, which suggests other kinds of disadvantages in the labor market. In France, we also see that the North African, Sub-Saharan African, Turkish second generations all have higher rates of unemployment. I might add much higher rates of unemployment. And when they are employed, they report being employed in jobs below the level of their qualifications at higher rates than do native French youth. I'll just interpolate here before I get to the US. I'm working now on analysis in the Netherlands with a CUNY graduate student, and we find that A, the Turkish and Moroccan second generation youth, again, net of their education, are more likely to be unemployed, and when they are employed, they are less likely to have long-term contracts. So in other words, they're more likely to be in precarious situations as of the sort that Arnie has described. Now, before 2008, employment was less the issue for Hispanic second generation youth. It's become more of an issue since 2008, but even before 2008, it was clear that second generation Hispanic youth were less likely to hold good jobs net of their education, for example, jobs with health and retirement benefits. Okay, even though the story looks like a kind of reproduction of inequality story, I want to point out here that there's another aspect to this that again is associated with the shifting demography. And in a way, what this suggests is that the kind of the surface, when we simply look at who is placed where, like through the media, say, may look somewhat different from what this picture that I've just presented may lead us to expect. So in the US, and we don't yet have research in other countries that would enable us to really look at this issue. What we can see are some important changes taking place in the top tier of workers. In the past, this was a tier that was really dominated by non-Hispanic white men especially, but certainly non-Hispanic white workers. The top tier could be defined as the people who occupy, let's say, the top quartile of occupations, where occupations are ranked according to their median annual earnings. So these are people in the best paying jobs, you could say. Thanks. And so what we see is a real decline in white dominance, sort of in past cohorts, like the baby boom cohorts. 85% of these workers were non-Hispanic whites. Among the cohorts now entering the labor market, it's down to about two-thirds are non-Hispanic whites. And I think this shift will continue as the demographics of young adults entering the labor market continues. And this growing diversity in the top is particularly associated with immigrant origin young people. So what we see is a rapid growth of the Asian share of the top tier, also a growth of the US-born Latino share of the top tier, not very much change in the representation of African Americans. And it's interesting that this is taking place even at a moment when economic growth has been limited, job growth has been limited. So it suggests that the demography will push on through even if there's kind of economic resistance to change. And I'll end on that note. Thank you very much.
So this is part of a collaboration with that's led by Jeffrey Mornoff and David Harding. And I'm here because I'm the one closest to New York City. So to provide some background for why you might care at a conference for unemployment and youth to talk about why am I going to talk about incarceration, I think that the issue is hopefully people understand it, but at this point, we've had a 4 times increase in the number of people incarcerated in the last 30 to 40 years. So during the period of great economic change, another thing's been happening, which is what we incarcerate 4 times more people than we used to. It's over 1 million people in this country. And this particularly influences young folks, also particularly influences minority. I've been involved in some work that looks at the involvement in the criminal justice system. And we've estimated about 50% of African American men have at least one arrest for a non-traffic offense by the time they're 26. So what you have is an environment where a criminal justice system has expanded. Incarceration is sort of the tip of the iceberg on that dimension, but it is an important dimension to talk about. And we want to understand the effect that, and it's now big enough that it can have macro effects on the environment. And the question is, does it have a causal impact on things like employment? This is a question that started receiving some attention, and the problem is it's somewhat difficult to study, in part because there are other things, you know, if you're going to compare people that are incarcerated to those that aren't incarcerated, there are other things that are different about these individuals that you want to control for if you want to look at causal effects. And so we have an interesting causal study that we believe allows us to control for some of those factors that advances the literature. And for a particularly large and relevant sample, which is all felony convictions in the state of Michigan from 2003 to 2006. So what we're going to argue is that we both expand the scope of prior existing work and also improve the quality. So in terms of the results, just to give you a quick sense of what we're going to find, we're going to look at this for 14 to 25-year-olds for whites and non-whites. And what we find is that there is, in fact, very clear short-term reductions, particularly for whites, and the long-term effects are largely isolated among whites. And we're going to talk a little bit about why that is. We're looking at 4 outcomes in what follows: employment, stable employment, involvement in poverty, and also participation in the secondary labor market, which is what has been colloquially referred to in the preceding conversations as bad jobs. So the secondary labor market is sort of bad jobs. So in terms of effects of incarceration, there's a number of different theories for these kinds of things. Essentially, there's some good reasons to think why incarceration might lead to bad employment outcomes. The probably leading stories are sort of your human capital degrades, your social capital degrades, you're labeled. Background checks are now very prevalent in employment, so people can identify you. They can't identify you typically as being incarcerated, but they can identify you as having a record. And also potentially cultural in terms of looking at things that you do in prison to survive may be bad and not very good to do outside of prison, particularly in terms of questioning authority, et cetera. So there's also a counter-argument that it actually increases employability in terms of providing some opportunity to get education. Most people who enter prison are not attached to the labor market ahead of time, so there is an opportunity here. And there is some evidence that people make decisions to change in prison. It's not, it's not the only thing that happens in prison, but people do have opportunities to change in prison as well. And of course, the biggest problem is the one I mentioned earlier, which is that people who go to prison might not look like those who don't for other reasons that have nothing to do with prison. There are prior work in this area. Perhaps your best known work in this area is Bruce Western's work. There are some issues with it, though. The biggest issue, perhaps, is that the methodological assumptions of fixed effects are probably not true, and also the comparison group in work like Western's and others is very, very fuzzy. If you're talking about increased incarceration, you're probably talking about not incarcerating other people, which would include things like probation or other community services. The comparison group in Bruce's work is anybody that's not incarcerated. And so in terms of for a policy point of view, it's not very helpful to as a comparison group. So what we're going to do is we have data in the entire state of Michigan from 2003 to 2006. It's roughly, in the age group that we care about, we got about 41,000 people. We have over 100,000 in the overall study. And we have unemployment records both before and after prison spells. And what we're going to do is do something with judges. So we have 35 counties represented and 151 judges. An important point here is that we have Detroit, which is relevant for discussions of non-whites because there's a really big difference in what's going on in Detroit versus the rest of Michigan. It's like tale of two different countries. The relevant sort of things going on here, we're not talking about, people that are highly educated for the most part, right? We're also talking about folks that do not have a lot of employment prior to their going into prison. Some of them, and also don't have huge criminal history records because they're fairly young. So there's a fair number of prior arrests, but no prior felonies for the most part, because they've been convicted or arrested for other things, but they're now entering the criminal justice system through incarceration or through probation in the sample. This is sort of what people have done in the past for these kinds of studies. We have whites and non-whites. A couple things I want you to notice from this picture. So this is 36 quarters prior to going into prison, and then zero is going into prison, and then zero is also a release. So we're going to ignore what happened in prison and what we're looking at after prison. And so what you find if we look at a couple of things, and this speaks to the fixed effect issue, notice that, so this is for whites, they look a lot alike. But the guys who go to probation and the guys who go to prison look a lot different in the 12 quarters prior to going to prison. So they're not a good comparison group for one another if you don't control for these differences. And the fixed effect assumptions would not hold because the fixed effect assumptions say they don't have to be the same level, but they have to be following the same path. Next thing that happens that people generally find is upon release, those that go into prison have better employment outcomes afterwards, but then it declines to lower levels on the way out. This may be because of required employment and parole. We don't know exactly sure, but this is a fairly common finding. You'll see the bump is also there for probation and also declines to levels before. The other thing to notice is that the non-white population, which in this case is primarily African-American, has the same pattern but are much lower levels. So the involvement in employment prior to going into prison is in the 20% range, which is exceptionally low. And this is a very common finding. So, but the other thing to notice in this picture is that we're missing the story about going to prison, and only looking at release sort of ignores the larger story of what's going on, and if you're thinking about the overall story as people move through their age. So what we want to do is we're making an argument in this paper that we ought to think about the prison spell as well. And so if you look at the prison spell, this is a very different story. This now zero is when you go into prison, and this is during the time that you're in prison. And what you'll notice, of course, is you're not employed in prison. And then as people exit prison and get jobs, they go up. But they never approach anywhere near the level they were before. Now, of course, some of these people are still in prison, and that's part of the story. But this is a much more holistic story of what's going on when you're talking about prison, if you're thinking about it in a proper temporal sequence. But you'll notice the picture is, this picture is identical. It's this picture that changes. And we think it's important to look at this picture rather than the previous one. And in fact, if you look at typical employment training programs, this is the picture you look at. You don't look at just when you get released from an employment training program. So what we're going to do is a natural experiment, which has stronger causal claims. It has some limitations because you're only going to identify your causal effect when you have for the people that were moved around by the experiment. We're going to look at judge identifiers because people are in New York and in Michigan are assigned randomly to judges. The effects when people have done this kind of thing before have shown weaker effects than typically shown by folks like Bruce Western. Typically, these have been for much smaller samples, specific cities and counties. And so what we're going to try to do is expand it to the entire state of Michigan. So we're going to try to do what people have done before, but in a much more precise way for a larger subpopulation. So the issue of this is, if we're looking at prison and probation, there's this problem of observed confounders. This is the selection problem. There's also which we can control for, but we also have things we can't control for that are unobserved. So what we're going to do is we're going to notice that people are randomly assigned to judges, and some judges are harsher than others. And so some judges are more likely to assign people to prison versus probation. We believe that judges are correlated with the observed confounders, but they're not correlated with the unobserved confounders. And that's the exclusion restriction. That's what makes this an experiment. Okay. So we have, we're going to study here as prison versus probation. We have a number of control variables, although for this argument, the control variables are less relevant because we're identifying it on the experiment or the natural experiment. This is to just show you that this is all the judges that we're studying. You can see some judges are much more likely to assign non-whites to prison versus probation. That's on the far right-hand side. And some judges are much less likely to assign people to prison versus probation. There's rather surprising amount of variation here in terms of probability of getting assigned to prison by judge. And so here are our main results. So this is for the fourth quarter after employment, where, in fact, after sentence, where a lot of people are still in prison, what you'll find is that there's a 19 percentage point decline in employment for non-whites and a 30 percentage point decline in whites. This is because whites have a higher levels of employment to start with. You also see that they're much less likely to be involved in stable employment. And then for whites, significant results are respect to both whether or not they're earning above poverty, or as well as whether or not they're involved in the primary or not secondary market. And so you can see that what we have are fairly large short-term effects. This is what we call incapacitation. These are people who are largely still in prison. But the effects are already different, much larger for whites, and have effects in both poverty and secondary labor market questions. In terms of the 5 years after sentencing, you can see the effects are still there for employment, although they're smaller. But the other effects for stable employment, earnings, and employment are only there for whites. Okay, so these are, again, smaller than the results found by Western, but they are sizable. And we would argue these are the right effects because it's not just release, it's just the overall story, which is a combination of both stigmatization and other things in the labor market, as well as the fact that some people are still in prison. And this is what I said earlier in terms of the results. We have this incapacitation effect, and then we have long-term effects that are largely isolated among whites. So in terms of thinking about why this is, first of all, we want to argue that our approach tells you the complete story. It doesn't ignore the incapacitation story, which we think is an important part of the story, especially in a world where both prisons, where prison spells are particularly long relative to the other Western world countries, as well as having higher probability of a prison sentence. But also, it also points out, I think this, our results point out another thing, which is that while lower prison would help, the baseline levels are so low that in some cases, you know, putting too much emphasis on the prison story, which obviously is part of the story here, or the involvement in the criminal justice system, overlooks the fact that baseline levels, particularly for what is largely, you know, the folks we were talking about before, lower levels of education, were very low to begin with. So the structural stories that get us to this point where we have large numbers of African-American, primarily men, isolated from the labor markets, not involved in sort of conventional society in that sense, who then enter the criminal justice system and the prison system, that's the problem. It's not re-entry. It's the fact that they haven't entered in the first place that deserves attention. So I'm assuming I'm close to my time, so thank you.
So while we're waiting, I want to say I have to thank Norma for giving me the title of doctor. I can tell you I barely graduated college. The only thing that I ever found I was particularly good at was organizing workers and changing their lives, and so my mother would be very proud, though, if she could have heard you say that, because she always aspired for me to be a doctor of some sort. So let me just talk to you a little bit about things we know. We all know these are bad times. We all can pick your particular issue that you think is confounding you or the country the most. I think the real question here is this a moment? Is this a trend? Or is this what Andy Grove, who's the founder of Intel, along with Gordon Moore, created the Intel chips? Is this a strategic inflection point? And strategic inflection points are very different moments because they really are turning points where either very positive or negative things can occur. And like the fact it took us a very long time to recognize that workers weren't getting raises for 30 years, it took like 20 years for us to look backwards and actually see that was a trend. And I would say there's at least two, if not more, strategic inflection points that are occurring that have very much to do with saying that this is not a moment, this is not a trend, this is a fundamental change in the way the world is going to work going forward for young people in particular. So the lines here are blue is productivity, red is jobs, green is income, and whatever that final color is, gray is GDP. So what you see is historically, all these things went up at the same time. That was the wonderful American economy that I grew up in. And at a certain point in history, we now know, it took us a while to recognize, that even though growth was going up and productivity was going up, people weren't getting a wage increase. And so therefore, the money that was being made wasn't being shared. But what hasn't been recognized, which is the current trend that will continue into the future, is you can have economic growth without job growth. So every politician is running around saying, let's just solve all of our problems by growing the economy. George Bush, 4%, Hillary Clinton, are leading us in a direction that's just not true. You now, because of lots of different factors, can have economic growth without job growth. And so growing the economy is not sufficient to get jobs. The second thing we now know is that the way work is done, the one job in a lifetime economy is gone. 30% of people are now part-time, independent, freelance, contingent, self-employed, whatever you may say. It's going to go up to 50% of the American economy. That is the way people is going to work. Some is a result of globalization. Some it's a result of technology. Some it's a result of employer power. But the truth is we are not, and ask the employers if you have any questions, we are going into a world where full-time employment is less and less without intervention into the labor market. That's just the reality of where we are going. And we also now know, as we can see pre-recession 2009 and post, that we're losing, as we all know, the mid-wage jobs and even the high-wage jobs, and what we're growing are low-wage jobs in America. Or someone said bad jobs, there's lots of different times. And if you want to know where this goes and why this is a strategic inflection point and not just a moment, we now have 24% in 2009 of low-wage jobs. We're going to almost 50% of people will work in low-wage jobs. And we've already heard about the disaster this is for college graduates. Shawn was saying to me before I came up here that enrollment is down at SUNY, enrollment is down at law schools. People for the first time in American history are questioning the ROI of going to get an education. And for good reason, because it turns out that getting a college education, even though more people are doing it, is not increasing people's wages. So the ROI is in fact down as well. And then if you really want to think about the future, this is a study that was done in Oxford, the most detailed study to look at what the effects of technology will be on jobs going forward. And I'm talking 10 to 30 years. I'm not talking tomorrow or the next day. 40%, 7% of all jobs are at risk that can be replaced by technology. Now, of course, everyone who has no particular way to prove this can say, yes, but that's what is said before. We're Luddites. Things have always come back. There have always been new jobs. I just say, tell me where they are. I'd love to find them. I love even the concept of what they were going to be besides caring for the elderly and some of the other jobs that will be hard to be replaced by robots, but people are working on it in case anybody has any doubts. So maybe this is a turning point. But what are we going to do if there's not enough jobs for everyone? And we're beginning to see the canary in the coal mine, which have been presented in many of the different papers before. We're beginning to see that the impact that once was on manufacturing is no on service. There's no economic law I've seen that says technology must create as many jobs as it destroys. So what is going on here? And I don't know how to do this here. So I just want you to listen for 3 minutes.
So according to an old legend, the inventor of the game of chess takes it to the Emperor of India and shows it to him. And the emperor is so delighted by this elegant game that he says, you can name your own reward. And the inventor, being a clever guy, says, Your Majesty, I'm a humble person. All I want is a pile of rice. And we're going to determine the size of the pile of rice by putting 1 grain of rice on the first square of my chessboard, doubling that, putting 2 on the second, doubling it, putting 4 on the third, so on up through 64 squares. And the emperor thinks the guy actually is being humble, so he kind of grants the request really easily. Now, those of us who have had enough math know what happens. Those doublings over time accumulate to the point that after 64 squares on the chessboard, you got a pile of rice the size of Mount Everest. It's more rice than has ever been produced in the history of the world. And in some versions of the legend, the emperor cuts off the guy's head when he realizes he's been had. Now, where I think this gets interesting and relevant for understanding what's going on with technology and the economy is at that point when the emperor says, oh, wow, this is not what I expected at all. Because Ray Kurzweil, who's a great inventor and futurist, makes the point that that realization happens right about at in the midpoint of the chessboard. So after 32 squares, you've got 4 billion grains of rice, which is a lot, but it's about what you'd get from one field. It's not going to bankrupt the emperor. It's not going to cause the inventor to lose his head. It's only in the second half of the chessboard, after you've had enough of those cumulative doublings, that we start to get piles of rice the size of Mount Everest, and we start to find that all of our experience and our intuition is no longer a good guide. So maybe the emperor's intuition was, I'm going to give this guy a field's worth of rice. That would be a legitimate reward. He wound up having to give him a Mount Everest worth of rice. That's the difference between the first half of the chessboard and the second half of the chessboard. The reason we bring this up in our book is because of Moore's law, which is the constant doubling of computer power. So very much like the piles of rice keep doubling, computer power keeps doubling. And we did a simple calculation, and we found out that if you take Moore's law into account and you start counting at about the time that companies started buying computers, we entered the second half of the chessboard in about 2006. Now, that's not a precise calculation.
So we enter the second half of the chessboard, where all of a sudden things are doubling out of control. This is today's economy. It's kind of interesting if you think about it. The largest taxi company in the world owns no cabs. The largest popular media owner creates no contact. At one point, Alibaba, the most valuable retailer in the world, has no inventory. And Airbnb, the largest accommodation in the world, has no real estate. And that is the future America economy on one hand. But on the other hand, it's an economy where everything that you've ever thought of that could be done in science fiction may very well become reality. Driverless cars will soon go on the road. People say people won't use them. It'll be the biggest public health advance
in the history of humankind, other than some of the vaccinations, as all of a sudden people are not killed on highways, but it also means there'll no longer be insurance agents, and there'll be insurance adjusters, there'll no longer be parts distributors, there'll no longer probably be parking lots, there'll no longer, will have huge impacts down the stream. If anybody is involved in medicine, I can tell you that what the idea of medicine was for me versus what medicine will be going forward is completely different in terms of where it's practiced, what role IBM and Watson and all the advertisement you see will soon play in diagnosing and predicting the future. And here's what we say when we confront all of this, what's the answer? Everybody says, oh, let's get more education, let's fix the community colleges, let's do more investment in research, let's get the market out of the way, let's invest in infrastructure or unions, all good things. All good things except for the market, out of the way. But the truth is, the tsunami that is coming to our shores is not going to be stopped by building sand dikes in front of the wave of change. And this is by Peter Orszag, who's now the chairman of financial strategy at Citigroup and Obama's OMB director, not me. So the main challenge of the economy as we go forward is shifting from producing prosperity, because we are going to produce, and this is not an academic word, a shitload of prosperity through technology. It's how we distribute the prosperity, because we have a distribution problem, not a creation problem here. And that's a political question, as Bob Kuttner would say, is how, who and how profits from it, and how do we share it? And that's a question that's up to politics. So let me just end by this. There's an old idea that's a new idea, because it goes back to Thomas Jefferson. It's seen its light many times, and it's called a basic income. It's basically an unconditional grant to every American. It is not a new idea. It's an old idea. It's a conservative idea. Here's Charles Murray, someone who, you know, doesn't usually share my political persuasion, but he talks about how the government spends more $1 trillion of wealth provided for retirement health care, doesn't think they do a very good job. Only a government could spend so much money so effectively. But his answer, his punchline, give the money to the people. That's what Milton Friedman said with negative income tax. Thomas Jefferson talked about with land grant, the new Liberal Party premier Trudeau. His father had an idea about a universal basic income in the platform of the Liberal Party that just got passed in his election is a call for experimentation in universal basic income. Now, that's the conservative case for it. Now here's a guy that we all kind of like, Martin Luther King. He had a different case for the same thing. He said the government believed it could lift up the poor by attacking the root causes, better housing, better education, better supports, too small, too disorganized. The programs of the past all have another common failure. They're indirect. Each seeks to solve poverty by first solving something else. I'm now convinced the simplest approach is to give people a guaranteed income. Joe Stiglitz just endorsed the Switzerland referendum. Robert Reich is for it, Paul Krugman's for it, and even Dr. Andy Stern at the bottom of this is for it as well. So the question of the future is, can we redistribute in a way that ensures that every American has a basic sense of security and stability, a floor? And then the second question for the young people in this room is really work our highest calling? Or is it simply now an economic necessity? Because if we get to the point where you don't have to work in order to provide people the goods and services, what will people do? And in my generation, it was unheard of to think of anything but work, but I think that's a values question the country is going to have to confront. John Maynard Keynes said, he said this in 100 years, he said from 1930, this would be the issue. For the first time since its creation, man will be faced with his real, his permanent problem. How to use his freedom from pressing economic cares, how to occupy the leisure with science and compound interest, well have won for him. To live wisely and agreeably and well. And 100 years from now, we have that challenge. It is here for us. Thanks.
Wow. Thank you. That was wonderful. And I'm assuming we'll attract lots of questions. I have many, plenty. I will start. I'd like to start with Mr. Stern. Sorry that I call you a doctor. You have so many accomplishments that we should give you an honorary title. And I'll be brief because I know we have many questions from the audience. The problem is structural. We need to redistribute funds for the poor or to the people directly. And let me say a structural analogy, and then I'll get to a sun-dyked question. I work with economists for a while at other universities, and I'm still learning a lot of their macro-structuring. But I understand, just comparing the United States with other advanced societies in Europe, that we our economic growth has been compared to, in my terms, since I'm a mother, to a gestational stage, right? Where you go through different stages and finally there's an outcome, there's a baby. I think we reach our gestational stage and we're moving on to a new economy. One which you predict, according to all the knowledge of the OMS, is that it's gonna be out of work and that people won't know what to do with that culture. The Sandai question is, I hear over and over when we have these kind of conferences that one of the solutions is that the jobs that are now available are those that cannot be replaced by automation. Hence, those that rely on social skills. And that the future culturally cognizant global citizens will be those that can be educated on social capital. How do we educate our students, for instance, at City College where I am, about the social capital that the middle class, you know, has so easily access to? That's a question to you.
So, I mean, I am not a great person to explain best how to do education, and I'm a big fan of economists, but I don't spend a lot of time around them because I feel like they look a little bit too much at the past to predict the future, and at strategic inflection moments is not necessarily as helpful as it might otherwise be. I think what we understand is we're going to have an oversupply of labor and undersupply of jobs. There will be a competition for jobs as we see now, and the top 10 or 20%, as we are seeing now, will do extremely well, and everybody else won't. And that your question really raises, yes, we can worry about, which we should, how to best train your child to get into the 20%, because you want your kid in the 20%. You don't want him in the 80%. But as a macro problem, there's still going to be the 80%, and we have to also account for what are we going to do about that, and not just say, go get an education, you know, do whatever it is that is today's, you know, go to community college, follow the German model, all good things, all temporary things, all inadequate for the future.
Thank you. The next question is for Professor Alba or Foner, whichever wants to address it. I see you find that in England, although you didn't speak much about it, but in England, given the time constraint, has the best case of where Antillians and Bangladeshis and Pakistanis seem to do better entering the university. These are mostly post-colonial, the children of post-colonial groups, but the same correlate is observed in Netherlands, where Antillians and Surinamese are doing better. They're like in the middle between the native Dutch and the Moroccan and Turks. Do you think that it has something to do with the post-colonial groups, for instance, in Netherlands, where I done research, having more in common in the language and the history and culture with the native groups than North Africans like Moroccans and Turks who are mostly Muslims?
Data to say on that. I mean, one question would be is whether those groups come with more human capital than some of the Muslim groups, which where we know the levels of education among Turks and Moroccans of the parents is very, very low, and it may well be, but we don't really have data to show that the Afro-Caribbeans in Britain and the Surinamese came with higher levels of education. We don't know. I don't know to what, I mean, some people might say language, but by the second generation, in the Netherlands, they're speaking Dutch, and in England, well, the English-speaking Caribbeans came with English, so. But, you know, the language, you know, it continues to be a puzzle. I don't know if Richard wants to.
I would just add, though, that the post-colonial story is not uniformly positive. Because in France, where there are a lot of post-colonial groups, they have done rather badly. And
They have suffered actually also from stereotypes that originate in the colonial era. This is particularly true for the Algerians, where there was, of course, a very bitter struggle for Algerian independence, and the consequence was a lot of the European settlers in Algeria returned to France and brought with them very negative ideas about the Algerian Muslims, who then became immigrants into France. So.
Thank you. I was thinking of the case of Mexicans internally colonized in the U.S., and they're having a different experience in the U.S. than the post-colonial youth in Netherlands and in England. And so to me, that struck me as very interesting. Professor Bushway, how much your paper shows very fascinating. I'm not a criminologist, but I've been trained by criminologists somewhat, and I eat dinners with them and read their papers. I'd like to know, one main contribution that your work does is that it brings in the bias selection of the judges, county judges. And after reading your paper, I wish I would obtain more information about that, because this is the first time that I see this analysis behind the stage, the hidden process that you talk about as to how judges are assigned for the county, for cases. And what do you think that this has, what we get is the outcome of being incarcerated and how people who are incarcerated, whether you're white or black, you have more to lose if you have been engaged previously in the labor market, which is part of the same inequality experience we all know about. But I think what is unique about your paper is that you talk about the assignment of judges. Can you tell us a little bit more what your findings are? Does it make a difference that a judge is assigned from a different county or that he has a different class or race?
So just to be clear, what we were doing was taking advantage of the fact that in Michigan, along with other places, judges are assigned randomly to cases at indictment. What that means is that you can't judge shop. You have to, your cases are sort of controlled, determine where they go. And sometimes that's done by courtroom. In this case, it's done by judge. And what we're utilizing that to, we're exploiting it, because not all judges sentence in the same way. There is some discretion in a state like Michigan. Michigan does have a sentencing guidelines. There are rules to follow. However, there is discretion. One of the founding principles of the judicial system is that you have to make individual case assessments. And individual case assessments are made by individuals. And some judges have different preferences than others. And so what we're doing is exploiting that. It's not all, that isn't the primary source of variation in outcomes, but it is a source of variation. And so what we have is a situation where we do what you couldn't do, which is you are randomly assigning people to prison because you are randomly assigning people to judges. Now, some people are going to go to prison no matter what judge they have, and some people are going to get probation no matter what judge they have. So our estimates are only relevant for people that were on the margin, where it makes a difference. And so these are within counties, so this is going to be assignment to judges within counties. So we're controlling for, so this is not between county differences, this is within county. So this is going to be only looking at, say, these effects are sort of within Wayne County, within the different counties in Michigan. But it is interesting, I think maybe somewhat shocking to some people, to note that first stage, right, that there is differences based on which judge you show up in front of. It's like I said, it's not the whole story or even the majority of the story in terms of your sentencing outcome, but it is something it's not something people actually apologize for in the courts. They believe that's a fundamental principle of what you should be doing in courts, which is these individualized assessments. The problem, of course, comes up if these individualized assessments are related to race or other factors, and that's a different story, that's a different question that's not being studied in this paper.
Thank you. I'd like to open the floor. Yes, please. How do we? I think I saw a first hand there, and then.
Michael Myers, New York Civil Rights Coalition's executive director. Going back to the real world, where there are prisons, there are going to be prisons. That means to me jobs. There's an infrastructure problem in America. To me, that means jobs. There's an aging population in America. That means health services and a service industry. That means jobs for quite a while. Going back to one of Richard's slides, I noticed that there were, in terms of making advancement. You talked about Asians and Hispanics in America. And you said that the African American is still not making those advancements and not breaking through, if I remember your slide right. Now, taking aside the issue of who's incarcerated, who has criminal backgrounds, I'm talking about the African American cohort who is not criminal. The African American cohort is who is qualified like the cohort of the white and eligible for employment. There still seems to be a problem there of underemployment and not being able to break through in terms of advancement for the African American in America. Why?
Did you want? Okay. So first task is pass it off. Yeah. Okay. So I will give you my speculation. It's certainly nothing that I could say I could prove. And I also want to be clear that the slide showed a particular form of advance. That is to say, it reflected people getting full-time employment in what I call the top quartile of the workforce as defined by occupation and the compensation for different occupations. So that doesn't mean that African Americans are being barred from other kinds of employment opportunities. Okay, that said, I think that in a way, I think that what we're witnessing is a kind of replay of what has happened before in American history, where immigrant groups have been able to forge ahead while African Americans have remained behind. And so I guess my view is that there's deep in kind of our culture, really, a preference for immigrants and stereotypes about positive stereotypes about immigrants, even the undocumented, if you will, as people who've come here voluntarily to work hard, to make progress for their families, and they remain, you know, deeply embedded in our culture because of our history of slavery in part. Negative stereotypes about African Americans and black workers in particular. And, you know, there are a number of studies of employers that show that at the low wage end of the labor market, there are clear preferences of employers for immigrant workers over black workers. So I think I would say that story can be writ even larger, and that this is a part of the reason, at least, why we see the immigrant origin groups kind of pushing ahead, kind of entering the upper ranks as this kind of demographic story plays out about declining numbers of whites. And we don't see as much forging ahead on the part of blacks.
If I could just add, and it's not having to do with the labor market so much, but drawing on our book, we also show that in the US, compared to other immigrant groups, black immigrant groups, and African Americans are heavily residential. Their rates of residential segregation are much higher. Their rates of intermarriage with whites are much lower. So it's a pattern. And this looks different, to come back sort of to Norma's, it looks different in Europe, in many Afro-Caribbeans, for example. In the Netherlands, mm-hmm. the Surinamese and the Antillians mm-hmm. Have extraordinarily high rates of intermarriage with whites. Mm-hmm. And Afro-Caribbeans in Britain have very high rates of intermarriage with whites. There are more black second-generation black Caribbeans who have a white parent than have two black parents. So, I mean, this is a reflection of the American racial history and its continuing relevance, unfortunately, in America, in the way it is continues to be relevant in America today.
Also, in your paper, you show that Afro-Caribbeans have a higher university enrollment rates than even the Brits. The native Brits, yes. So that's very interesting. Yes, please, I have next to, please, you. I'm sorry, I don't see your name from the here. Reimers. The Cordelia Reimers, yes.
And I have a question for Shawn Bushway.
Oh,
I thought I was, I don't want to get too close. You showed that the effect of incarceration was much greater for whites than for blacks, because the black level was so low to begin with. I'm wondering if you have any sense of what the effect of arrest records is, differential arrest records there. Is arrest record one reason that the blacks start out from such a low level in your data when you're looking just at incarceration effects?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's an interesting question because, you know, theoretically at least, African-Americans and whites, relatively speaking, who go to prison should have roughly similar prior incarceration records, which is about right. But I think it does highlight a point that I've made in my other work, which is I do a lot of work on the effect of criminal history records on employment, and is that if you're focusing on prison, it's sort of too late in the game because a lot of the effects of employment are on convictions, which happen. Most people who go to prison have at least one conviction prior, which isn't really clear from our data because we've focused on arrests, but at least one conviction prior. Only about 20% of the people who go to prison have no convictions prior to going to prison. And so, in fact, their employment outcomes are already bad before they get there, which you saw in our picture. So the question, and so then there's two parts to the question, is why is there a difference for whites versus African Americans, and is it driven by arrests rather than, say, convictions? Arrests, you know, some of you are familiar with the work of Deepa Pager and others who have looked at audit studies. And the audit study she did was in New York and also in Milwaukee. She did two. One were of people that were incarcerated. Both had one had a person that incarcerated. An African American had an incarceration record. Another African American without an incarceration record. They both applied for the same job, and they also did the same thing with white pairs. And they find that there's an impact of a fairly large, sizable 50% decline in the probability of getting a callback. And it's hard to know if that's incarceration or the conviction record. There has been a subsequent study by Chris Eugen and colleagues looking at arrest records, minor arrest records, and the difference is much, much smaller. It's marginally significant. It's 4%. It's very small, 4 percentage points. So I don't think the evidence is that arrest records might be driving the problem, but it is, in fact, possible that conviction records are driving it prior to going to prison. But that doesn't answer the question: is if African Americans and whites have a similar sort of criminal history which require to prison, why is it that whites have a higher employment prior to going into prison? So you know, let's not be overly. I mean, it's not like they're doing really well, right? It's below 50% prior to going into prison, but they're doing better than African Americans. And I have a hard time understanding if that's related to the conviction records, that there's a differential effect for African Americans versus whites, but I don't know. And particularly because the evidence would suggest that for, you know, the evidence that I'm aware of is that, you know, African Americans without records have a harder time in the labor market than whites without records. So the puzzle, I guess, in your question is really what explains the pre-existing differences for those who are going to go to prison or probation, and it's not conviction records because they both have very similar sort of stories.
Yes, but before, I wanted to also suggest that perhaps it's the kind of labor niches in which African Americans are concentrated that usually increases also their chances of being arrested. Yes, sir.
Ian Shore, I have a question for Andy. I really enjoyed your presentation, and I thought it lucidly laid out the proposition that really you can do all you possibly can in terms of community college programs to help create skills for people and various social programs geared to trying to create the type of training where people could go out and get jobs. But the reality is that over time, those jobs just may not be there. And if that's the case, I then get to the last slide in your presentation and you start to talk about, well, maybe 20% of the people will literally have jobs, 80% won't, and we therefore simply have to ask those 20% of the people to provide a guaranteed income for the 80% of people that don't have jobs. My question to you, is that a prescription for both political and social unrest.
Well, excellent. I think the fact that any time we bifurcate societies, we create the ingredients for social unrest. And I can tell you the ruling class is very nervous, and the tech elite are very nervous about, you know, social instability being created by sort of the bifurcation of all of this. So, and I like to say, you could think of this more like a Vietnam War moment, which will date me tremendously, where middle-class parents and elite were very concerned because the draft could affect their children, versus the Iraq War, when all volunteer armies seemed to sort of be someone else's problem, or blue-collar manufacturing jobs going away, which was, why didn't the kids just get an education? Now that lawyers and doctors and anesthesiologists and accountants are beginning to fearful of their jobs. So I think there's a lot of grist for organizing right now, and that will only increase. And, you know, I don't think, you know, how you pay for a universal basic income, you know, people have everything from a cap and dividend, like there are certain things like the air and the airwaves and intellectual property that should pay a fee that helps people do things. I think there's a lot of questions. I think the issue we don't want to come to grips with, and certainly the political establishment wants to come to grips with, is that there is a huge problem coming, right, that can't be fixed by what we like to talk about that once could fix the problem, like education and training and aligning the community colleges. And unless we sort of get to the scale of the problem, a lot of people are going to be hurt. And that's what's beginning to happen to college graduates. They are being hurt. They are taking the jobs of people who once had a high school education. They're saying, isn't it great they're doing better than people of a high school education? Yeah, but they're getting absolutely no wage advantage in the long run by getting an education. And parents are now not sending their kids to college or sending them to not high-priced college because they get it. We just haven't, as a elite society, kind of got it yet.
I just wanted to raise that as the conference goes along. It's interesting from last night to today that I think some interesting debates are going to come up and perhaps be able to be synthesized and integrated. So last night, Robert Kuttner, who I see just at this moment walked left, was calling for full employment and for a political solutions that have to do with job creation, went over the history of that. And so, you know, and there's an interesting question, is that in debate or can go along with what you were saying, Dr. or Stern?
I would just say, I mean, this is where I come down at a different place. I think you can always do anything you want about full employment. You know, I mean, I hate to say it, but, you know, lots of oppressive regimes, you know, employed everybody, building pyramids in foreign countries or whatever. The question is the future about making people work because we as a society value it, or it is about giving people choices? So if you had $1 trillion to spend and you could put everybody to work as a home care worker or a prison guard, or you could give the money to the people and let them take care of their families or do whatever else they want to do, which would you do? And I think that is a very fundamental debate about, I don't believe in building a full employment economy so we can make everybody work because of our Puritan values. I think there's a whole vast opportunity that we've never had a chance to experience before. And for young people, we should open our minds to not be like old people and say, you got to work every day for a living to prove you're worth something.
Mike Hout, you heard from me earlier. I'd like to point out a fundamental difference between what Ian said and what Andy's saying. Ian's saying the presumption in your question is that the money belongs to the person who has the job, and in Andy's there's some collectively, you know, if you had as some kind of benevolent income distributor, the money, and I think that few American workers realize that, you know, that they don't really own the marginal productivity of their labor, even though we all act as if we do. I did not build my university. I did not build the university that educated me. I am lucky enough to be paid a salary that stands on top of a really large institution that, frankly, nobody owns, even if the president acts like he does. And therefore, in order to get from Ian to Andy, what we need is somehow a different way of articulating the collective production that is America's wealth, instead of it being the property of the lucky 20% who are employed, or however we choose to articulate the ownership of that wealth.
Thank you. In the back, please.
I'm really curious about the role that labor institutions play, especially in the 2016 election, and why aren't they / we, the royal we, I guess, talking about the youth on an underemployment crisis? And, you know, looking at the agenda of labor, you know, and talking about a $15 wage, minimum wage, is great progress to where we came from, but is still grossly inadequate to increase and create a quality of life for all workers. And so when I see labor kind of pull the $15 minimum wage almost arbitrarily, when, you know, other numbers are closer to $22 or $23 an hour or something, you know, and that sets the agenda, the political agenda that organizers and the infrastructure kind of gets behind, you know, what happens to us? What happens to my generation when we're talking about a $15 minimum wage years from now in New York even? And then how does that play out in this next election, and in New York at least, the election in 2017 and 2018 in the city and state, you know, and talking about this issue that we're here for today?
I'm sorry, and your question?
My question,
exactly.
Yeah, I'm kind of just talking
no,
here.
No, no, very, very, very interesting,
loud.
And I just...
Yeah, my question is, you know, what role do labor as institutions, especially in a state like New York, play in both the 2016 election, but also in addressing this crisis, this youth on and underemployment crisis? So I'm sure this is for Andy Stern, but also open to others.
Who would like to address that?
So I mean...
For Stern?
Yeah, it is not unusual that major institutions, you know, have a hard time reinventing themselves to be as relevant and thoughtful in the future. And so I'd say we're having a very old discussion, right? I think the $15 is a huge opportunity to change people's lives, and that's what labor institutions do. It is a strategy that has a financing problem in the long run, so it will run out of steam in a short point, and we'll still have the same crisis. Some people may be paid better, but lots of people won't be paid very well at all, or won't have full-time jobs, or can't get their schedule straight, or many other things that unions used to do as an institution. So, you know, to me, I think we just have to reframe this discussion, because it isn't about youth unemployment. They're just the canary in the coal mine, right? Just like people who are incarcerated are another version, and immigrants of certain, you know, or other versions, that when there's a limited number of jobs and people are competing for them, some people do better and some people do worse, and people out of the labor market tend to do worse than people that are in the labor market, you know. And so we are just, what is happening to youth and what is happening to people coming out of prison will only get worse because technology is only getting better. And, you know, law school applications are down 30% for a reason. Lawyers can't find jobs. And we haven't even gotten to accountants and insurance agents like we did to travel agents and other people. We just eliminated huge potentials of jobs. And medicine is the next thing on the line, which has been the big growth, along with growth of better jobs compared to the retail sector of the economy, because they've been tended to be more full-time, you know, just because technology. So the future is coming, right? We can all talk about what used to work. The economy should grow, people should go to college, we should do infrastructure, we should have more unions. It's sandbags in the face of a tsunami. Better to have sandbags than no bags, but it's not going to stop the rain of destruction.
So you're recommending that we change the structure of institutions? I'm sorry, I'm just trying to get the response as well.
Well, I'm just saying most institutions, you know, Silicon Valley creates new things faster than existing large corporations create them. Pharmaceutical breakthroughs tend to be done by people not in big pharma drug things. They buy the ones that do it. And I just think counting on large institutions to reinvent themselves who were successful in the past to be the future is not what's going to happen here. It really is going to be in organizations that you never heard of, worker centers, other people sort of rising up using new tools to create new models.
Thank you. I think I have Professor.
I have a question for Professor Stern, Dr. Stern.
All of the above.
I do agree with you that the future is coming, and I do agree the basic income idea, which has been around for a while, as you point out, is an interesting idea, and I think we should think outside the box. But setting aside for the fact that it's probably politically impossible in the United States, given the values, the work-centered values of America, I also agree with you that. That we got to focus on the demand side. I mean, we can't focus on the supply side so much. I mean, we need education, we need skills and everything, but we have to focus on the nature of the jobs. But I think that this idea that we're gonna enter a world in which we don't have to have jobs or don't have to work. This has been around a long time, and it technology destroys jobs, but it also creates them. And there are many service jobs that cannot be replaced by technology and cannot be outsourced. And so now, I don't think big corporations are going to reinvent these things, but I do think there's a groundswell of entrepreneurial activity in this country. I see a lot of students wanting to go into nonprofits, various things. So I do think that instead of blowing off the idea of work, and I hate to do that, I would focus on reinventing it. I don't see a society in which people will not work, because work has so many functions besides earning a living. It connects people to each other, et cetera, et cetera. So I would maybe adopt the idea of basic income partially, but I would focus my policy efforts on the demand side. And I do think that your efforts through the SEIU and this kind of thing has a lot of exciting things happening with the worker movements and those.
Thank you. I think at this moment we have 8 minutes left. We're going to take questions all together and then try to have them answer as we can. Yes, because we don't want to hold you from lunch. This one here. Professor Ruschek.
My name is Stephen Ruschek. I had a question for Professors Alba and Foner. So am I correct to assume that diversity amongst elites, into that sort of top quartile of occupations is not true in Europe, right? Not to the same extent? And if that's true, right, if the sort of diversity, the growing diversity we see in American top quartile occupations isn't sort of happening in Europe, then the theory isn't just the demographics of baby boom being important, but baby boom plus something, right? So how do the different baby boom demographics affect situations differently in Western Europe and the United States?
Richard. Yeah. We're catching all the questions. Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Yes. So the first one is...
I apologize.
Yes.
Any other questions? Any other questions? Then go ahead and answer.
You had your hand up before? You had your hand up before? No? Okay.
My question is for you as well. I'm having a hard time envisioning this world where people don't have to work. Maybe because it's ignorance or too young to have seen this idea circle several times. So I wanted a picture of that. And then I was just wondering, does choice doesn't necessarily have to mean not work. Choice could just mean choice in what you do rather than being a prison guard. I forgot what the second example you gave. So I was wondering if you could paint that picture a little bit more, talk about what choice would mean, and how do you prepare people to take advantage of that choice?
I admit it is impossible to imagine a world that no one's seen, just like it was impossible to imagine the Industrial Revolution when you were a farmer your whole life. And so
dreamers, you know, technologists and other people are inventing. You know, if you read Ray Kurzweil's predictions 20 years ago, he did way better than any political prognosticator did about who's going to win the Republican primary this year. So what is the question of what, as someone said, what is work? I mean, for a long time, women have been saying, I've been raising families, why is that not work? I just don't get paid for it. So I think there is a legitimate question. I'm not saying everybody's going to sit around and play video games. I'm just saying maybe you're a part-time farmer. Maybe you take care of your mother. Maybe you work 12 hours a week instead of 40 hours a week. You know, maybe you write and, you know, instead of having to wait tables all the time, you just try to get your acting career in order or post it on the internet. So I think there's a redefinition of work that's absolutely essential. And I don't think it's either work or don't work. I just don't think you work as a full-time, necessary 40-hour a week life experience, you know, going on. Two is I just want to say, I'm not sure this happens, but if I'm in the military, I'm wise enough when there's a probability that climate change will affect the security of the United States besides affect the health of all the people. I create scenarios of what we do. I don't get why people in our country, and I'll say this particularly about progressives, have to think there's one way or the other way, right? Why? We do know the Industrial Revolution devastated people in the transition. People were poor, they were hungry, they had no... So why do we want to wait to see who's right or wrong? Why don't we just say this is a very conceivable scenario that we should have a set of policies in place before people really get hurt, you know, and we have to do it. So I happen to believe it's going to happen, but I think there are other scenarios as well.
Great, thank you. I believe there is someone in line. Rushik had a question to
Real quick.
Oh, you're going to add to the question? Yes.
I wasn't asking a question. Okay. One of the issues in our data that comes up is that we're looking at unemployment insurance, which is a very formalized type of labor market. And if you ask people the same types of folks whether they're working or not, their answers are twice as high as that. But they're involved in the informal labor market. And it's true that minorities are more likely to be involved in the informal labor market. And I think that in that sense, they're the canary in the coal mine, that the extent to which that's actually happening much quicker and broader in that environment than it is in others, and so, you know, you could argue that we're not paying attention to the whole story, and we're a little too stuck on the old formal labor market, in part because that's what we can measure, but also, you know, maybe it's not as important as it used to be, and that's a different question that maybe needs to be answered in that, you know, cross context.
Thank you. I think we have two more minute and a half left. I'm not sure if.
Well,
yes, Richard, would you like to address Rushik's question?
To answer Professor Rushik's question, I must have expressed myself much too briefly. So I think there just isn't the data. People aren't looking at this in European societies in a way that would enable us at this point to answer the question. In the book that we wrote, one way you could maybe begin to think about it is in terms of political elites, because we do look at who gets elected to office. And I think the big story really everywhere is that the immigrant populations are really making their presence felt in terms of who gets elected to office at local and national levels. So that suggests that the US is not likely to be an outlier in terms of the penetration of immigrant groups into the top jobs. Yeah.
Okay, we have time. Thank you, Richard. We have time for one more question. I think I saw the hand over there. I don't know, you had someone here, I'm not sure who came first.
It seems that one of the problems people have in getting employment are credit and background checks. And I wondered if you feel that there needs to be some new thinking about them for the future economy.
Excellent.
So first of all, I mean, I think there already is new thinking, and this is an area where you can actually talk about regulations making a difference. The EEOC has put in new guidance that has changed the way background checks occurred and eliminated, I think, the use of arrest records that used to be much more common. It's not done as much anymore. And also, I think it's affected that, you know, people, I think, are much less likely to have blanket bans on people with records than they used to. I'm not saying it's where it needs to be, but I think there has been dramatic changes in how people use these records, and it's the result of direct result of government intervention. So, I mean, I think it's an area where, you know, people are, you know, there was a conversation that I've been very much involved with, which said, well, ex-offenders and people with records always look higher risk than everyone else, and the question is, well, that's actually not true. After about 7 to 10 years of non-offending, they look a lot like everyone else. And so the question is, okay, now how, you know, but not everyone should be waiting 7 to 10 years, and so how do you sort of take into account the risks? You know, we're doing a study in nursing homes employees instead in New York. Everyone has a background check for people that are direct care. Okay, you have the risk, the vulnerable populations that you're trying to protect, but you also have people who actually appear to be benefiting from getting a job. And so there's a balance that has to happen, and I think that conversation is happening more than it ever used to, and I think it's one that is going to continue.
Thank you. I think we have concluded, and want to thank the panelists for a wonderful presentation, and the audience for the engagement, and I welcome you to a lunch upstairs. Are you going to announce it?